I'd be speaking to you on choroidal coloboma with the retinal detachment. This is somewhat slightly different from the talks that you have heard before. So the choroidal coloboma is caused by a congenital defect. It's a congenital defect caused by the improper closure of the embryonic fissure. It is seen to affect about 0.14% of the general ophthalmic population, and the prevalence of retinal detachment is 3.96%. Now, it's commonly seen in the second decade. Most of the patients have other features like nystagmus, which is seen in about 44% patients. There is also a possibility of lenticular opacities and iris coloboma. Now, 74% of patients had also got a colobomatous disc in the coloboma. The detachments due to the breaks in the coloboma is seen in majority of patients. That's about 58.8%. And PVR is rarely present in this condition. So the good thing is that we rarely see PVR, primarily because the breaks occur in the coloboma, which does not have the retinal pigment epithelium. As you would have known, that RPE is the primary cause for inciting PVR occurrence. Now let's look into the pathology of this condition. So if you look at the margin of the coloboma, the retina splits into two layers at the margin. The inner layer continues over the coloboma as the intercalary membrane or the ICM. Now, other swept source OCT further shows that the ICM can have schisis, cysts, and breaks. So these are additional changes which could occur in the ICM, which would predispose the ICM to develop breaks. The outer layer turns outwards and becomes disorganized and merges with the retinal pigment epithelium. The choroid also stops at this margin. We also see vitreous adhesion at this margin. So this margin is very crucial in the occurrence of retinal detachment. This margin is called locus minoris resistantiae. So if you see, this is a coloboma. So the inner layers of the retina continue as the ICM, and this margin is called the locus minoris. So the breaks can occur in three locations. As we have seen, predominantly it's seen within the coloboma, that is, it occurs in the intercalary membrane, or it could occur at the junction. Now, there has to be a communication that occurs to the subretinal space, so there has to be a break in combination of the two, or there could be break in the periphery. So it is not unknown that retinal detachment can occur due to breaks in the periphery. Now, if there is a break in the periphery, then you would also observe that the retinal detachment does not extend completely around the coloboma. So this would give you a clue that there is a break in the periphery. However, it's very difficult to identify these breaks because patients have microophthalmos and nystagmus. So it's always very tough to identify a break. If you are able to identify a peripheral break, then scleral buckling surgery is an elegant technique for this condition. But most of the breaks occur in the locus minoris and intercalary membrane. So this would require vitrectomy. One should not try to do a scleral buckling in this condition because this would invariably fail. So you need to do a vitrectomy in this condition. It is difficult to detect the breaks preoperatively. So be ready that you will not be able to see the breaks. So there are standard ways of doing it, and that works out very well in this. You need to identify the vitreous. You need to use triamcinolone. A lot of times there would be other abnormal membranes which cause these adhesions. Then once if you clear the vitreous adequately and then you do a fluid air exchange, because there's a break within the coloboma, you would be able to drain the subretinal fluid completely. So this is a very good way to analyze whether the break was within the coloboma. So once you're able to reattach the retina, you do laser to the edge of the coloboma, and then you can use a tamponade. Most frequently used is silicone oil. However, you should be ready to know that the emulsification occurs very early in this condition. So you have to be prepared for an early removal, because if you leave it longer, glaucoma is very common in this condition. The gratifying thing is that anatomical success is in about 87.4% patients. So this is a video of a patient who had a coloboma with a retinal detachment. So as we completed the core vitrectomy and started use the triamcinolone to identify some membranes that were seen around the disc. Fortunately, in this patient, the disc and the macula were away from the coloboma. So this patient would have a good visual prognosis. So as we proceeded with the vitrectomy, we could see that there was an area where in the inferior part which was attached. So we know now that this is not caused by the coloboma, but a break which has occurred in the periphery. So I put in PFCL, did the laser around the edge of the coloboma, because this would be anyway a weak site for recurrence of detachments. And then I had to identify the peripheral break, which was not seen preoperatively. In spite of scleral depression and examination, we couldn't detect the break. Then on examination, we could see that there is a break in the periphery, and this we could identify it, and then we did the laser around it. So the breaks are very small in this. So you sometimes it's very tough to make out, especially because there is nystagmus and you don't see them. And then I could do a fluid air exchange through that break and reattach the retina, and then used a tamponade. We were able to attach the retina completely. This patient had the breaks within the coloboma. So after I did an adequate vitrectomy, there were some membranes that were seen near the edge, because vitreous adhesion is known to occur at the site of the locus minoris. So you have to be very careful to see that all the vitreous adhesion is clear, carefully removed. Once you have done that, I just did a fluid air exchange and the retina flattens out, because the break is in the coloboma. A lot of times you're not able to identify it, but that would be the lowest part. So the fluid tends to collect there and you're able to aspirate it and retina flattens out. And then once you flatten that, then you can proceed with the laser at the margin. So this is a much more simpler way than all the exercises that you could see with patients with PVR. Fortunately, in the primary surgery, it does not occur. The occurrence of PVR is only due to iatrogenic breaks that occur during surgery. So you have to be careful to see that you don't cause them. Now, this was a patient who had, you know, a sort of a closed funnel detachment in a patient with microphthalmos. And what we could see was there was some sort of a coloboma inferiorly, but it was not very evident at that time. There was also lenticular opacity. So on dissection, I could make out that the vitreous is very thick and it was very adherent. So I had to try to clear the posterior pole first. So I dissected it from the disc margin, and I had to use the forceps to clear up that adhesion. It was very dense. See, these patients also have other congenital abnormalities. So one has to be ready for all this. You can see this is a very thick membrane, a very thick membrane that was there. And then I started with the similar technique as what you do for PVR. We put in PFCL and then you start dissecting further. So then after we did adequate, started using the PFCL. And then started, you know, as much vitrectomy as possible. As we go to the periphery, the vitreous was very thick. You can see the coloboma is present inferiorly. So I had to use the PFCL as a third hand to, you can see the vitreous is very, very thick in this condition. So I had to see that there's adequate relaxation. This patient had a break in the periphery, but as I was dissecting it, the break enlarged, and I used that to drain the fluid from that break. I put in PFCL, drained it through that, and then used the tamponade. So one has to be ready that you would see abnormal vitreous in this condition. That's the only care that you need to take. Otherwise, the surgery is generally straightforward. The PVR is seen if you create breaks, so you have to be very careful in not causing breaks. Now, coming to a very other aspect of it is, can we prevent retinal detachment? So in a study done on 335 eyes, they found that the prevalence of RD with prophylaxis was about 2.9%, and the risk in untreated eyes was 24.1. So this clearly showed that there is a role of laser prophylaxis in patients with choroidal coloboma without retinal detachment in order to see that we don't develop, they don't develop retinal detachment. Remember, these are children, so you have to be very careful to see that you're able to do it. You might require general anesthesia in some of these young kids, but one should also be aware that the fovea, the macula, and the disc margin should be avoided. So you have to be very careful depending on the type of coloboma one can treat it. So in conclusion, retinal detachment due to choroidal coloboma is relatively rare. There are specific clinical features that you should understand because that will give you a guidance on how you should proceed with surgery. Breaks within the coloboma are the most frequent cause. So that is the standard way that most of us should do surgery. Vitrectomy fortunately gives us good results in this condition. Thank you.